ensure that the results are fair, accurate, transparent, and a representation of the will of the people of the United States.
So my suggestion would be, and of course there are several different remedies that you have. One would be to declare that the votes that were not inspected properly be declared null and void in that county and deducted from the vote total. Essentially, what they were doing was Wisconsin has the strictest absentee law in the country. They require an application for every ballot. And when they finish, they only count the number of absentee ballots that have an application. They deduct from the total from that county whatever are missing. So if you have 5,000 absentee ballots, but only 4,000 applications, you deduct 1,000 votes. And the reason they do that is to deter people from doing that in the future. But look at it this way. If you didn't deduct the 678,000 whatever it is votes that were not counted, there's no penalty for it. What stops them from doing it again next time?
Right.
And this is a question of not voters acting improperly. It's a question of the inferior offices of the state, because they're inferior to the legislature in this regard, acted improperly. They conducted a completely sham election. They're the ones who have to be penalized. It's a little like the exclusionary rule in criminal law. They've got to be taught you can't do that. The other thing you can do is you can demand to see all of the envelopes that were cast aside. I will virtually guarantee you're going to see a couple hundred thousand envelopes that have no names, partial names, the same name. You can ask to see the ballots. You're probably going to see ballots that are official and ballots that are unofficial. You have two major gaps. You have the 672,770 votes that were not inspected by anyone, secretly put into the ballot box. And then you have this gap that I don't understand between the mail-in ballots you sent out, 1.8 million, and the number you counted, 2.5 million. That's totally impossible to explain, other than what some of the witnesses were suggesting, that they were basically stuffing the ballot box. I believe what happened is they never expected to be behind by 700,000 votes on election night. They expected to be behind by a couple hundred thousand. In Philadelphia, there's still a couple hundred thousand votes. They do it every year. That's not going to be tough. Now you had a real big problem. So you had to create mail-in ballots. You had to stretch it out for a while. We didn't go into detail on the Dominion system, but we have two other experts who can show you how they injected votes into the Dominion system. And also, so I think I would settle this election, but I would definitely appoint a special prosecutor to prosecute the people who conducted this election. You might even ask just a general question, how did the governor and the elections commission, how could they have selected a company that counts our votes outside the United States?
Amen.
I didn't know that.
Representative Mall, questions for any of our panelists?
This is like our lightning round here. thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think what I'm going to do is make more of a statement to throw out a timeline because to try to reiterate what everyone else has already done. Just be, a couple of years ago, our Supreme Court in Pennsylvania very illegally redrew congressional maps. It's very clear in our Constitution that is a legislative act. Fast forward a couple months ago, our Supreme Court rewrote our election law. Again, that needs to be done in statute. It is a legislative act. When it came to the mail-in ballotings, that House bill, was it 77, Act 77, I was really kind of taken aback by how eager the governor was to sign that bill. Normally, bills can sit at his desk almost 10 days before he signs them, or lets them become law under oath or veto them right away, and that one he signed almost instantaneously. And I just kind of wondered, so after I saw what happened in the primary, I wrote House Bill 2626, and this is where it kind of locks it in for me, Mr. Mayor and panelists. In House Bill 2626, I saw where there could possibly be stuffing the boxes. So I said, simply, let's put a barcode on the bottom of every mail-out ballot so that the machine has to read a barcode that was accepted by the elections office. Before that ballot goes out, they zap it. When it comes back, if that barcode doesn't match one of the barcodes that they sent out, it gets kicked out. The governor immediately, as soon as we ran that bill out of committee, said, that is my desk, it's an automatic veto.
Wow.
Not everybody knows that, but that came to us. We had to literally strip that out of the bill. And I will be reintroducing a bill to barcode any ballot that gets mailed out when we get back. Trust me. Then we have the drop boxes, 3 days extra to vote, the ignoring the signatures and ignoring the postmarks, and I have to come to the conclusion that you did also. If it looks like corruption, smells like corruption, it's corruption. And we've got to get the bottom. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your testimony. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Senator Reagan. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you to all our testifiers today. It's been very informative. My question, Mr. Mayor, you touched upon it briefly, but I wanted to just, if you could delve a little bit more into it. Attorney General Barr, shortly after the election, authorized the U.S. attorneys across the country to investigate allegations of voter fraud. I wonder if you could tell us about the criminal investigations that are going on, maybe specifically in Pennsylvania, by our U.S. attorneys, maybe our FBI, and tell us how that is going, and is there any evidence that's been presented to you, or are you made privy to any of this information?
I'm sorry, Senator, I wouldn't be made privy to that criminal investigations. And in my experience, criminal investigations, you know, will take too long to help you in your most immediate decision.
Yeah.
Criminal investigations can help you in your long-term decision as to how to reform so this never happens again, which I think you all will want to do. For example, not ever hiring again a company that counts votes in Frankfurt, Germany, that's owned by two Venezuelans who are very close to Hugo Chavez and Maduro. That's extraordinary. And unfortunately, we don't have the time to really analyze the votes. Although, if you want to go into greater detail, we have other forensic experts that can show you votes that were specifically put into the machine, because these machines have a back door that allows you to do that. So I would say the criminal proceedings are going to take 6 months to a year. What you have before you that you can verify is you have before you very, very clear evidence. It's not small. It's not as if these are a couple little mistakes that happen. I hear people say, well, every election has a couple little mistakes. Not 682,000 ballots that nobody comes to expect that from time immemorial. We've never had trouble in America with absentee ballots. I've been in absentee ballot contests in New York, and they can, you know, they can be pretty vicious, and the language is worse than that parade experience. But we would never think of having one without the Republican there and the Democrat there. Even in New York, we would never think of it. Here, they did it 700,000 times. That's an insult to the legislature, because they didn't provide for that. And you've got this gap of 700,000 unexplained mail-in ballots that come out of nowhere. So I think you have more than enough to say that this election, the numbers don't add up. It's easy to figure out what the right numbers are by excluding the illegal votes and count the honest votes, and the winner of the election changes.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
going to make a couple of comments. First off, I want to thank everybody for coming out here today. We need your support, your continued support throughout this whole process, because we're going to also get the other side that don't want us to do anything at all, and we definitely need to do something. We need to correct this problem. My county chairperson, Lisa, did an excellent job explaining what was going on in Northampton County. One of the biggest things that bothered me more than anything else was people that went to vote and they were told they already voted. That happened. I must have heard it from 50 people in my district. So, you know, they made them sign a provisional, and I called up and I said, you better make sure those provisionals are counted. And some of the other things that were happening, that you know, most of the stuff that you said out there, it happened in every county. But when you didn't want to vote with your absentee and you went in, you're supposed to get a ballot, not a provisional. And there were people out there that got provisionals. But just a little information for all of you. The new machines, this new process, we didn't vote for it. That was something that was pushed by the governor. He mandated that all of the counties had to go and change their system because he wanted some type of, what we don't have is a form to see who voted, it won a certificate or something, a slip to see how you voted, who voted. And it's obvious that the system has not worked, and the people of Pennsylvania are not happy about it.
Right.
Thank you.
Madam Majority Leader-elect.
Thank you. First of all, I just want to say what they did in Philadelphia when they closed us out and made us go to court to do what we should have legally been able to do is a travesty to what we in Pennsylvania need to have confidence in our elections. That should never happen again, and we should probably tighten our law so that it can't. Secondly, I'm extremely bothered by the absentee ballot and the mail-in ballot request number being almost 700,000 off from what we received. And so we just did try to get on the Department of State, and they did take down their dashboard. So we can't even check it. So if you have any of that information, any pictures or any, you know, website downloads, we would really appreciate having those because they took it down. So I don't know. Everything they do, it looks like they're trying to hide something, and it really, really continues to erode any kind of confidence in our process.
Senator, what I would suggest is they decided that morning, maybe a couple of days before, to exclude you because they knew what they were going to do. It wasn't an accidental sort of whim to exclude all Republicans. It's unheard of to exclude all Republicans. They excluded you because of what you received. You received ballots that weren't properly filled out. You received ballots that were filled out at the last minute. You received them start to get reports of how far behind they were because they were connecting to Dominion and Smartmatic, and they were telling them how far behind they were. And you would have caught them right in the middle of the fraud. And why create this big problem for yourself of excluding Republicans in six states, hundreds and maybe thousands of them, if you're not doing something wrong? If you're doing something that, as the senator said, is kosher, come on, look, who cares? This big thing wasn't done because they were conducting an honest vote. It's kind of crazy to think that. This was done because they knew only way they could steal this election. And when he was ahead by those numbers on Tuesday night, Wednesday morning, they panicked. Also tell you there's an expert witness who can testify that this pattern fits the pattern that Smartmatic used in two elections that they stole from South America. When the election was getting too far away, they called a halt in the voting count. Or there was a halt called in six places, including in Pennsylvania. In one place, they made believe there was an overflowed water tank. It happened if you went to the toilet bowl. It took a two-hour halt. And in Michigan, they brought in 100,000 ballots ballots through the back door and counted them with nobody observing them except three people who happened to be remaining behind. That's evidence that's also in affidavits and could be presented to the Michigan legislature. Those people are willing to testify. And just one other thing, these people are very brave people. A lot of people aren't testifying. Obviously, we can't present all of them. I want you to know that all of them are backed up by numerous